Hi everybody, welcome to AI Development 101. In these videos, I'll be using this whiteboard to explain the key concepts behind AI technologies. And we'll go step by step, starting with the basics of machine learning and ending in more complex concepts like reinforcement learning or even massive NLP models and AI supercomputers. You can watch more videos like this here, including the equivalent series for AI in Business 101, or follow me at LinkedIn here for new videos. Okay, so let's start with the foundational element behind AI, which is, of course, machine learning. Today, we are going to do like the hello world of machine learning. So the essence of machine learning can actually be summarized with this math expression, y equals h of x. That's it. That's the most important math that you need to know. Why? Because at the end of the day, a machine learning model is just a function that is going to take an input that we will call x and an output that we're going to call y. And the input is going to be a number or a series of numbers, so a vector. For example, it could be your sales history or the pixels in an image. The output is going to be a number too, a vector, or even a list of categories. For example, the objects identified in a picture. So our job in machine learning is to find that function h that can transform the input x into the output y. For example, it's going to transform our past sales history into an output with a guess on the forecast for this month. So it's called H because it's the hypothesis function. So it's guessing that output. So now this is the interesting part. How could you approach this in traditional programming? In traditional programming, you would develop a program implementing that function H. So you will need to find out an algorithm to predict your output, whether it's a sales forecast or identifying pictures of dogs and cats, which is quite difficult. So then the machine would take the input, the program implementing H that you develop manually, and it will create that output Y. But in machine learning, you won't be creating that function by yourself. The machine is going to take examples of inputs X with their corresponding outputs Y. And then with those, it will guess the hypothesis function, so H. So in a sense, the machine is learning by itself based on examples instead of being programmed manually by you. So let's say this is an example. Imagine that you have values from a research on patients of diabetes. Now, this is actually a real example that is often used as the data set for the hello world in machine learning. So in the y-axis, you could have a number representing the evolution of a patient with diabetes after 1 year. And in the x-axis, you're going to have some attribute of the patient. For example, the body mass index, the BMI. Now, let's imagine that you have only a few patients. For example, patient 1 with the values x1 and the output y1, patient 2 with x2, y2, patient 3, and patient 4. With this data, my goal now is to find a function h of x that can predict that evolution of a new patient with a new input BMI that I haven't seen before. The easiest way of doing this is called linear regression. And it's super simple. What I'm going to do is assuming that the relationship between these two is linear. So my function would be something like this. So hopefully you remember the equation of a line. It's something like this. H of x equals theta 0 plus theta 1 times x. Theta 0 and theta 1 are called the parameters of my model. In this case, I have only two. In future episodes, we'll see crazy models with billions of parameters. Now, the key concept in machine learning is finding the right values for these parameters. In a way, what they represent is I'm trying to represent my samples as good as possible. So that process is called training. In the case of a linear regression, it's quite simple. You want to find the parameters theta 0 and theta 1 that create a line like this, instead of a line like this. So an approach for this could be to get a measure of how good my function is guessing the samples that I have already. So what I'm going to do is to apply the line to the values x of my examples. So that would give me a predicted value for each example. y1 predicted, y2 predicted, y3, and y4. You can see by the way that I'm using that symbol over the letter y, that's a common way of referring to the predicted output. Then, how do I measure how good is my model? What I can do is taking the distances between the real output and my prediction. So that would be this distance right here, this distance here, this one, and this one. Now I need to come up with a formula bringing all of these distances together in a measurement, so in a number. And this is a critical concept in machine learning. So keep it in your mind because you are going to use it a lot. Remember this, that measurement is called the cost function. The cost function will use some equation, some formula, to give you a sense of actually how bad is your model. So you will find this function to be referred as J, and there are many types. A simple way of defining it would be just adding all these distances. So Y1 minus predicted Y1 plus Y2 minus predicted Y2, and so on. And you can divide it by N, so you have an average. But this one is tricky because the distance could be negative, so they will complement each other. So another option is to have the absolute values. So that would mean having the absolute value of y1 minus predicted y1 and so on. So the most important one, the most popular one, is actually using the squares because that will penalize the predicted values that are very wrong. So the formula would be y1 minus predicted y1 squared plus y1 minus predicted y2 squared, etc. You can use the summation notation to make this even more compact. And you're going to use these summations in most of the math for machine learning. So it is good that you get used to it if you haven't seen it before. In this case, it would be the summation from i equals 1 to n of each of the distances squared. All of that divided by n. It's just a more compact way of saying the same thing. So the average addition of all the distances squared. That's it. And this function is super popular in machine learning. It's called mean square error, or MSE. So summarizing all of this, the cost function is a function that is measuring how bad my model is. And a popular one is the mean square error, which is just adding the square distances of my predictions compared with the real values that I have in my sample dataset. So now my goal is to find the values for theta 0 and theta 1 that minimize the cost function J. Now the good news is that there's actually a closed solution. There's a formula that will give you directly the values of this theta 0 and theta 1 that are minimizing that function, which is awesome. However, I said that there's a solution, but not that it's an easy one, because the equations are quite long. So what I'm going to do is just putting them here, so you can see here the final formulas for theta 0 and theta 1. And you can if you want the details behind this, you want to see the math behind this, you can find it anywhere. The approach is called the normal equation. Super popular, you can find it online. So the key thing of this formula is that they will give you the output, as an output, the optimal theta 0 and theta 1 for that line that we saw before. So the resulting h of x will be your first machine learning model. Congratulations. Now I can get a new value for the body mass index, the BMI, and I can estimate the output of that evolution of that patient. So this is like the hello world of machine learning. Unfortunately, things are going to be a little bit more complicated because the output in this case depended only on one factor, the BMI. But in real life, it will depend on multiple factors. For example, the blood pressure or the age. So instead of having as an input one number, we're going to have many. We're going to represent that with a vector. So every sample will be now a vector with multiple numbers, x1, x2, all the way to xn. Each of these numbers is called a feature. So BMI is a feature. Blood pressure is another feature. Age is another one. And the number of features is called dimensions, or just n. My training dataset will now be a collection of vectors, one vector for every patient. So I will have the vector x1 with the features for patient 1, x2 for patient 2, and so on. And the output y will still be a number in this case. So the good news is that the linear regression that we saw before can also be used for these multi-dimensional features. We just need to add the additional dimensions with a new parameter for each. But here's a problem now. As I increase the number of dimensions, the equations to get the values for each of those parameters is going to be more and more complex. And eventually, it's going to be very slow to compute. In the diabetes dataset, for example, which is super simple, we'll have 442 samples and 10 features. So the resulting equations are going to be humongous. They are not going to fit in this whiteboard. In other cases, it's just directly impossible to find the parameters for the model with a closed solution. So how do we solve this challenge? We'll see that in the next episode, but here's a little spoiler. We're going to use a technique which is absolutely fundamental to machine learning, which is called the gradient descent. So remember that you can watch these videos at aka.ms/AI101, and you can follow me in LinkedIn for new videos at aka.ms/DavidC. Thank you for watching.